evening, everyone, and it's a pleasure to be a part of this faculty and this thought process. It's actually interesting when you have to think through why we do what we do on a sort of inherent basis every day. And this is a fun part of what we all do. And for those on the call, I'm sure similarly, this is all about picking up pearls and bits of wisdom from all of our colleagues as educators and as sort of lifelong learners. And let's see if I can advance here. So Babak was able to show us really a lot of the technical aspects of nerve repair. And obviously, we all hope that when we sit down at the OR table that our first case is the one on the left here, and we can pull out our micro instruments and move forward in our case. And one of the challenges, I think, over the course of the year is that's the excitement of our trainees as well. And we have to figure out, how do we get to that place where we're sitting in the OR table ready to actually throw some sutures into a nerve or repair the nerve or do a nerve transfer to bypass a zone of injury? And these really come down to some foundational competencies. And part of this is, as educators, is to create a curriculum for our trainees, knowing that our trainees are different. They have different expectations. They've come from different backgrounds and experiences. But at the same time, we have to really be able to define competencies. We have to be able to draw on the resources. I've just recently moved from Duke University to the University of Colorado, and resources may be different in one place than another, both internally and externally. But we want to take those core components of understanding why and what we do for nerve injuries and integrate this into our clinical practices, and gradually over the time of whatever the training period might be, is to make sure that we review and confirm competencies or mastery of different aspects of nerve repair. So why do we sort of cultivate this curriculum? Well, it's easy to sit down and read a book and say, I'm going to go ahead and do this. Maybe it's to fulfill some lab requirements, as Dr. Safa pointed out, but we really want to get them to the clinical experience where the 10,000 hours issue and concept is really critical, particularly for a really specialized aspect of something like nerve repair. We also have time limitations, and we have to be efficient in the way we translate and essentially offer our knowledge base and our experiences to our trainees, because they'll come and they'll go. And we have to realize that, as I mentioned, every trainee will have individualized needs and experiences. And that goes to expectations and goal setting as both a part of the curriculum, but as part of being a teacher and being a good learner. So when I think about core knowledge for nerve surgery, it's sort of, what do I teach? And that may be in the classroom, it may be in the lab, it may be in the OR, but ultimately, it's a curriculum, and it goes through these points as we all can read here. And it's about decision making. And it includes things like outcomes assessment. How do we really gauge what we do and be able to instill into our trainees the importance of outcomes assessment? Because it helps us to get better at what we do, because we can reflect on how we did something and maybe we could do something better. And that's understanding the basic concepts of nerve repair, to managing associated injuries, perhaps. We often have to draw on our resources, some limited, some expansive. And this might be inclusive of faculty. And I would encourage people to sit down at the beginning of the year and draw in people from other specialties, neurology, neurosurgery, our radiology colleagues, people who can really expand the way we think about what we do. Peer learning is critical. They're internal resources, and we think of our fellows and residents as learners, but they're really also teachers, and we should really expect them to graduate along the way to the next levels of teaching, because it will inspire all of us through conferences, journal clubs, labs, clinical experiences over the course of a year. And it's really about engagement. The more you get people thinking about nerve surgery, the more they're going to engage and learn from clinical experiences along the way that Dr. Lee will talk about. And external resources are particularly important, and perhaps even in the somewhat muted environment that we're in now in terms of having conferences in person. But we can still draw on community and regional instructors, visiting professors, external conferences like specialty societies. The Hand Society is not in person, but there are lots of online offerings that still can lend themselves to flap courses, micro courses, and so on, but just nuanced in the way that we teach. And obviously, as Dr. Safa pointed out, industry courses, the lab courses that are put on, particularly for fellows and residents, are really a goldmine of opportunities for being able to interact and bring in other opportunities for learning. And obviously, Zoom and webinars such as this one through Doc Matter and others really has expanded, and I think has been a great, essentially an unwittingly a great way of learning, because we've reached out, we've interacted with other institutions, and it's not just the Dr. Safa way or Dr. Lee way or Dr. Leversedge way. We're integrating our ways to learn from one another. If you're sitting down and designing your curriculum, don't forget that many have done this ahead of you. And so there's lots of resources that are external to your institution, perhaps Handy from the Hand Society, the SHU curriculum. These have been put together by people who think a lot about education. And sometimes these can be great learning resources for our trainees, just like the videos that Dr. Safa showed us, things that can be quick access, refreshing for quick learning, but also can be very impactful in the way that we think about how we do things, because they come from reliable sources. Clinically integrating what we know. So when we think through the classroom experience, the lectures, the case reviews or case conferences, it's really about, why do we teach this? It's about bringing together the knowledge and skill development to be able to give our trainees experience. And ultimately, it lends itself to these competencies, which I like to sort of look at for nerve surgery as sort of a core knowledge, problem solving. How do we make decisions about nerve surgery? And then the technical aspects about what we do. And each of those has an interplay with the other. It's really about the importance of what is taught, and then learning how and when to apply what is taught. In other words, what do we do with this case here when we're sitting down in front of it, but how did we get there, as I pointed out at the beginning? And this case, which is just maybe technically straightforward, putting the nerve together, may have some complexities to it, a simple branching point, or for our trainees to learn from a book about the different ways of repairing a nerve, group fascicular repairs, and so on, but then applying it to say, when do I do this? I think importantly, as Dr. Safa was alluding to, having some feedback is very important, and getting our trainees to critically think about what they've done and how can they do better. And so if you look critically at this nerve repair, this might be great because it's time to go home at 3 a.m. after a long micro case. But really, if you really critically assess yourself and your technical ability, what happens when we repair a nerve like this? Well, we go back to the books and we learn about from articles and outcome studies about the way nerves are repaired, and that helps us with our technical aspects. Or this type of a scenario with a gunshot injury, when do we resect back and where do we resect back to? And how do we make the decision that maybe we should be back here, pulling in the microscope, the technical pearls that come from education, from a mentorship model? And then when we really wish we were doing something like this instead, then when things aren't quite so simple, and this is a picture from Kyle Everland, who points out in a very dramatic fashion here that the red side of maybe perhaps a technically gifted repair wasn't outside of the zone of injury. And so as a result, because it should have been at the yellow arrow, a neuroma formed because of the zone of injury was still present and wasn't evacuated. So these are the little things that make a big difference. Then we have to review with our colleagues and our trainees, what did I teach? Not only to be a better teacher and get some feedback from our learners, but also to reinforce what we've taught, to be able to help recognize the clinical condition, and then to be able to review the steps in taking care of this. And we've already had the analogy of the 10,000 hours, but I think repetition in different forms, even for core knowledge, how do we apply our core knowledge? Not just the repetition of throwing a suture really becomes important, because as we all know, I think I haven't met the same nerve repair twice or nerve condition twice, meaning that all of those 10,000 hours are seeing a different nerve injury from a different perspective. And that repetition allows us to use our experience to make critically good decisions. But then we have to confirm those competencies. So as our trainees go through their year or their multiple years, how do we make sure that they're making the right decisions and technically doing the right thing? And confirming this can be very challenging if you haven't defined the competencies to start the program. And it's very challenging for students these days to say, well, you need to give me a list and bullet points of what we want to know and what we need to know, and then I'll solve those issues for you. So defining the competencies allows us to confirm the competencies in different ways. Haptic technologies, and as Dr. Safa pointed out with his example, computer-aided ways of determining technical competencies, these are very, very helpful and will probably help us to advance our technical skills. But we also have to learn ways of advancing our core knowledge, accrual of core knowledge, and our application of that knowledge to get into the OR. So can you apply what I taught? Well, this is goes to assessment, and importantly is the formative feedback aspect, where we're continually able to give feedback to our trainees. And there is nothing worse than at the end of a rotation, 3 weeks, 4 weeks later, to feel like you're giving somebody feedback in an anonymous form when they can't really still apply that information back to what they're actually doing at the time of their rotation. So I'd encourage you to incorporate formative feedback into your teaching methods. And obviously with that comes graduated responsibility. And in a sense, that's the way that we test competency, is to let them see if they can get to the next step. So just to finish, I think we need to be practical and say, draw on a few practicalized items. So as we all recognize the Sunderland classification, it goes back to the no nervous injury is the same injury. And there's the classification of nerve injuries, but we all know that nerve injuries, such as a gunshot to the sciatic nerve, really incorporates multiple aspects of trying to define the actual injury, define the zone of injury, and actually figure out ways of managing the zone of injury or the injury itself. And perhaps a more simplistic way from an anatomic standpoint is transitioning from the book stage of learning, which is important because we need our trainees to understand the very core basics of anatomy. But as we think about our curriculum, how can we improve the visual and perspective? Because as surgeons, we need to know the relationships between nerve, vessel, tendon, artery, et cetera. And so the more we can enhance our curriculum, the more perspective our trainees receive. And in similar fashion, as they go to maybe reconstruct a median nerve, they need to know that there's a palmar cutaneous branch or recurrent motor nerve branch, and that these are important as part of their thought process about how they're going to go about reconstructing the nerve, because they also then need to go to the next level, which is to understand that there are interconnections and anatomic anomalies that will influence the diagnostic workup of a patient and even the treatment of a patient, depending on the interconnection or anomaly in anatomy. So the patient that comes in with the unfortunate post-carpal tunnel release injury, how do we really stress all the aspects of core knowledge and diagnostic decision-making to figure out what the treatment might be for a patient who's got considerable dysesthesias after their surgical block is worn off? And when do they intervene and how do they figure out what to do? Because ultimately, we can't let this be missed, but at the same time, we want to make correct decision-making steps. So they have to recognize the condition, and part of that's from the understanding of anatomy, the understanding of the critical aspects of subjective history taking and clinical exam, even from mock and interactive exams and patient workups, that really is critical for the things that get us to the operating room or keep us out of the operating room. And the same with diagnostic testing. Remember that tests are clues for us, not definitive answers. And so the accumulating experience of our trainees will help them to find more and more clues. And this is an example of a patient that came to me as another opinion, but was being set up for their third revision median and ulnar nerve procedure. And whoever it was taking a look at this patient took one step back and a careful look at the patient, including their history, they would have maybe not missed this tragic metastatic adenocarcinoma within the brachial plexus. And that's just goes back to the basics. It's not about testing, it's about the basics. And I'm going to finish on this one because my heart is oftentimes in anatomy. And this is a really nice study that Jim Higgins showed us. And it's about zone four digital nerve injuries in the palm. And if you go back to the basics of anatomy, you might recognize the zone of injury, but also importantly, the knowledge of nerve anatomy, which is the cross-sectional area and the number of fascicles. If you're really looking for a good autograft solution for this type of a problem, you really only have one that might match the zone four size and cross-sectional area, which is sural nerve. And so these little bits of knowledge help us to make decisions, whether it's an autograft or an allograft. Obviously, we're here compliments of Axogen's putting us together. But the critical step here sometimes is really knowing your anatomy. And so if you say, well, what innervates the lumbrical muscle to the index finger? And you think about that zone four injury as you're doing your dissection to clear off your tissue to put in whatever graft you're putting in. Hopefully you don't forget the answer to that trivia question, which is what we want our trainees to learn, is that the motor branch to the lumbrical is off of the common digital nerve in the hand. So it goes back to the fundamental principles that will really help us with our outcomes and our patient care. And I will finish there and look forward to hearing Dr. Lee's presentation. We'll come back at the end for some interactive discussion. Thank you, everybody.